have Jin Liu from the University of Illinois Urbana-Champaign to talk to us about supermassive binary black holes. I know that's near and dear to many people's heart. So before coming to Urbana, Jin was actually here for, what, some 8 years ago?
Yeah.
She was actually a postdoc.
2 years here, yeah.
She was a postdoc here for 2 years, and her husband is also an astronomer who was also here and is now also in Urbana. Right below you, said,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, we are a binary.
Yeah, they're binary. She's at the top, he's at the bottom. There's some sort of significance there.
But we're here as well.
But it's true here as well. Okay, fabulous. So without further ado, thank you.
Thank you, Eden. Pleasure to be here. So today, I'm going to tell you about a field that's been driven traditionally by theory. But over the years has attracted a lot of attention in the observational community as well. So I'm going to explain why that is, what we have learned, and what's going to happen next. So the picture here, this is the poster child in our field, so NGC 16240, which is a so-called dual-agent system, a galaxy merger that have two active galactic nuclei at the center separated about 1 kiloparsec. So the fact that I want to highlight here is that it's really important to see in multi-wavelength or multi-messenger in the end. So this is a color composite. What you see is optical and also X-ray, which we love. So I'm going to flip you through it. So this is the optical. What you see is only, you know, the only central region, and you don't even see the two black holes because it's so obscured. But this is the X-ray, where you actually, people confirm the presence of two active black holes, okay? So the question that we are going to address is this galaxy special, okay? Or perhaps every other galaxy also went through this phase or is going to go through this phase. Okay, so that's the question in mind. Okay, so let's start from our backyard. Okay, so our Milky Way is actually in a crash course with the Andromeda galaxy. Okay, not gonna happen anytime soon, so no worries, but perhaps Andromeda is our only true friend in the long term, right? Depending on how, you know, the nature of that energy turned out. So we are really in the prime time of doing extragalactic astronomy because, you know, if in the far future and going through this runaway expansion, then none of the light will ever reach us for these extragalactic galaxies. So it's really dim, the future. But depending on how this goes, there is actually a silver lining to this at the end. We're going to go back, but this is just a teaser. And but what about other galaxies? So this is a Hubble collection of all the interacting galaxies at low redshift, so really close to us. So you can see the really fine details, so it looks like. So there is 6240. But there's also others, right? So this one looks like it probably gone through a merger in the past, right? So we want to know what happened in the past, right? So we're going to build a time machine. So there we go. This is the Hubble, one of the Hubble Deep Field, one of the deepest image on the sky, so where Hubble just stares at it for so long that you look into the far, the distant past of these galaxies because of the finite light travel time. So almost every single dot in this is a galaxy. So perhaps from 10 billion years ago, the light was emitted and now finally reaching us. Now, this is almost the same region of the sky, viewed if you have X-ray vision, right? But we don't have X-ray vision, but the good news is we have Chandra, right? So this is also one of the deepest image on the sky, is the Chandra deep field south. So Chandra just stares at almost the same region, and what you see is these supermassive black holes that is accreting gas. So gravitational energy being extracted from matter that's falling into it. So if you now, if you have a microscope that is, you know, powerful enough to let you zoom in about 10 orders of magnitude in scale, and this is what you will see. But of course, this is just an artist's impression of what's going on. So the gas is so dense, so hot, it's glowing in the X-rays, right? But you might wonder, like, how do we know? Like, we can't really resolve, right? We don't have that, you know, super resolution microscope. Well, the reason we know is that we can do spectroscopy, right? So we can resolve the kinematics and perhaps also the geometry using the, you know, resolution in velocity in this case. So what you see here is the iron K alpha line that is, you know, coming from a material that is really close, probably a few terrestrial radii to the black hole, and this is what we know as how we know it should be, you know, an accretion disk. And the fact that you see this shape is, you know, perhaps one of the strongest evidence for the presence of these supermassive black holes. So people can make model taking into account, you know, relativistic effect, and then reproduce this line shape really well. So resolution is a big theme in my talk. Okay, so if you piece that all together, right, so our premise is really simple here. So you have galaxy mergers, you also have black holes in them. So the natural question to ask is, you know, what happened to those black holes when galaxy merged, right? So this was, you know, in the early days, actually people figured this out really soon, and it was, you know, one of the motives for putting a gravitational wave observatory in space, because the supermassive black hole binaries, they are so massive, so there's no hope of hearing them on Earth, just because you need such a long baseline. And it makes sense to put a probe, the so-called LISA mission, in space. So the gravitational wave, so we are now finally in the gravitational wave era. So unless you've been living under a rock, I don't really need to explain this, but it's just, again, important to realize we really need sort of the multi-frequency, multi-wavelength gravitational wave astronomy. So LIGO is here at the high frequency end, but we also have, so now already, operating and providing a very interesting upper limit. So these so-called radio pulsar timing arrays, which use precision timing pulsars to detect the time delay that is caused by an ensemble background of the supermassive black hole binaries, opposed from these galaxy mergers. However, there's a problem, because as we will see, there's actually no confirmed case of a binary supermassive black hole in the gravitational wave regime or about to enter that regime. So that's a big question mark. So what happens? So it's time to go back and check our assumptions. So before I go to this slide, I also wanted to point out that you may notice that not every, you know, the number counts here is much less than, you know, what you see in Hubble, right? So there are, you know, two major reasons for that. And one is, you know, black holes, they are not always active. So they went through these duty cycles, and they perhaps are more episodic than we thought they would be. So that's why you see only, you know, maybe a fraction of, you know, any given galaxy that is actually hosting these active, so actively accreting and growing black holes. But there is also other reason, like more practical reasons. So you really need very sensitive, you know, X-ray or, you know, other indicators to see. So which is one of the reason why these NGC 6240 type of system is so difficult to find. Okay? So that having that in mind, we will go to the really core slides of my talk is the following slide. So what do we really know about these? Okay, so when people make these population synthesis models, you can go from a dark matter halo merger model, and then you populate your halo merger tree with galaxies, and then you assume they host a supermassive black hole, assuming some galaxy black hole correlation, and then you can produce or predict a signal of gravitational waves, and then you can compare with PTA limit, basically. But what people have realized is there's increasing evidence for attention between the two. So basically, we're supposed to see a lot more signal than we actually observe using positive time array. So what happened? So I think there are two major uncertainties in this. One is that the galaxy merger does not mean binary black hole. Okay, so you have a galaxy merger, but what really happens down to kiloparsec and subkiloparsec is not really well understood. So perhaps there is a bottleneck at the really large scale, perhaps on the order of kiloparsec, where you can imagine situation where if the black hole that the galaxy that is falling in was somehow stripped out. So they don't have their stars to go through efficient dynamical friction, then they may be left with this black hole by itself before it actually reaches the center region. So this is the so-called wonder black hole in halo. So that's one possibility. But there is also other possibilities, such as in some perhaps more exotic model for dark matter, the so-called fuzzy dark matter model. You can actually, because of the fluctuation in the density distribution, you can actually pump energy into the binary, so that the net effect is that you are not supposed to see any binary black holes that are separated by much less than about 1 kiloparsec. So things like that. The bottom line is it's still uncertain how would it be a million year, or would this be longer than the Hubble time before it actually reaches to become a bound binary. So the other uncertainty is that, okay, even if you form a binary, okay, so that's so now we're lucky, but what happens next is also uncertain. And this is ironically not because of our insecurity with general relativity, but really because of the earlier part of the evolution, which is the Newtonian part of the problem. So because you can imagine there is coupled accretion and the dynamical interaction in ejecting stars, that the full physics or astrophysics combined here is what's making this time scale so uncertain. So you can have from the order of millions of years, or maybe 10 billions of years, or longer, again longer than the Hubble time. So this is the so-called final parsec problem. So this is an old problem, but it's people tend to just assume it away in some sense. But I think it is still being debated, when and where we have this problem, in what type of galaxies. Okay? Right, so I forgot to mention there is also a question mark for the occupation function, right? So which is the fraction of galaxies that actually holds a supermassive black hole at its center. And is increasingly uncertain as you go to lower masses and go to higher regions. Okay, so that's another uncertainty here. Bottom line is we need to figure out the dynamics and the time scales, because they are relevant for predicting the strength of the gravitational wave signal. Okay, so the following two slides is just a summary, and this is my overview, the outline of my talk. So it summarizes what was happening in the last decade or so. So, see, I don't know if you get accused of STEM collecting in your field, but I think as a field, we need to go beyond that stage, right? So the short version of the message is this. Right, so there you have it. So you have NGC 6240 at the low redshift and at about 1 kiloparsec. So that's where it start get interesting, right? Because of this possible bottleneck at the galaxy sub-galaxy scale, and we're plotting the separation as a function of redshift. And now we're hoping to filling out this program, and this is the progress so far. And I haven't been really exhaustive here, but just highlighting some of the work I will be talking about. And the problem can by and large be categorized into two regimes. So one is before the binary actually, or should be called a binary, so before the kiloparsec or really the tensor parsec scale. So they're still, you know, sinking in through dynamical friction with the background star, so they are not yet a binary, right? So we're just, broadly speaking, sometimes people call binary quasar, binary AGN, so there is a, you know, ambiguity here, but there they are not really a binary. But the other case is that this the subparsec scale where we think they should be the most abundant, right? So this is relevant for understanding directly the population that is about to enter the gravitational wave regime. So the as I have alluded to, the challenge really is you need systematic survey that is large so that you are winning in terms of probability of actually seeing those rare event. So in my talk, if a black hole is not active, we wouldn't see it. So you need these large surveys. And the other sort of difficulty is that basically for these systems, right, so the very close binaries, is probably impossible to resolve even with interferometry, like VLBI type of resolution, as you go to you know, substantial redshift. So we have to rely on some indirect methods. So, right, so resolve the kinematics and the geometry either in velocity or in time. Okay, so remember that iron cap line that I show you. Okay, so I will go into the detail later, but this is not to overwhelm you. You can pick your favorite telescope or mission here. But the bottom line is because of the multi-wavelength property of AGN or these active accreting black holes, you really maximize your chance by, you know, combining a whole range of tracers, right? And depending on where they come from, right? So you basically effectually have this array of probes that you can use to study a binary all the way from the galactic scales to the subgalactic, subparsec, and finally the milliparsec gravitational wave regime. So that's the message I want to get across. And okay, so this is the final slide before we go into details. But how many of you work in exoplanets? Oh, no. Well, I expected more, but okay, so well, I was going to say that we actually borrowed a lot of the techniques that we use from the exoplanet community. And because if you think about it, this is essentially the same, because we're you know, trying to find, you know, some binary motion. This is what we can do, right? Astronomers were good at finding like Keplerian motion, right? So starting from maybe 400 years ago. So every single technique listed for exoplanet, we have these brilliant ideas, you know, proposed by theories, of course, that can be used to find it. So there, we are not lacking of ideas. Okay. So again, this is not even exhaustive. So I apologize if I neglected your work here. But the bottom line is that we have these techniques. So what we didn't have was the actual data to utilize for these techniques. And so I have highlighted the methods that I'm going to talk about today. But if I have extra time, I'll probably also mention briefly about the second and the third. And so they are, the flag at the end are just, you know, for the relevant physical scales that are, they are being used. Okay. So before, okay, so this is just so that everybody is on the same page. Okay, so I thought it would be useful to go through the relevant physical scales. So there's, as you see, there's, you know, almost 10 orders of magnitude of range in physical scales that we're talking about. And this is a slide that I stole from the internet. But the bottom line is that, so we're looking at scales that are really different from the scale where gravitational wave emission is going to be efficient. Right, so if you're talking about the narrow line region, for example, which we're gonna explain next, is you know, on the order of 100 parsec-ish. So this is the region where you have the dynamical friction. And if you're we were talking about the broad line region scale, which we'll talk about next, is much smaller than this, but still about two orders of magnitude bigger than the region where you will have these gravitational wave emission efficiency. So let's get that straight, okay? So, yeah, so this is the scale that I'm gonna be focusing first. So just to, the first example that I will introduce you to is a well-developed technique by us and other groups. So it is designed to search for the so-called dual AGN, so the gases that are really similar to a GC6240, okay? And this is how it works. So the analogy here is you have a spectroscopic binary star, okay? So you have two active black holes. For typical narrow line AGN, this is what you see, right? So you have the H-beta, O3 emission line, all good. But occasionally, about 1% of all AGN, you see this velocity splitting, okay, that probably points you to this orbital motion. Again, note that the dynamic is still dominated by the gravitational potential of the host galaxy stellar bulge. Okay, so using this Doppler effect, we're probably seeing evidence for these orbital velocity of on the orders of hundreds of kiloparsecs. So that's neat, but the problem, however, is that we have these imposters, and they turn out to be substantial, right? Because, so on the left, I'm showing you an actual confirmed AGN. So this, by the way, this was part of my thesis work where I was fortunate enough to use Magellan, and that was basically the best observing run that I had. And then from there, it basically went downhill. So I just used all my beginner's luck, I guess, all at once. But yeah, anyway, so the, but it turned out that in a lot of other cases, right, we have these bicone-shaped outflows, right? So what you see here is an example, Mercury 78, where you have these very smooth stellar background, but sitting on top, you have these biconical-shaped O3 emission that could also give you this velocity splitting if you only have this spatially unresolved spectrum. So how do you find out? And one way to find out is that you use X-rays such as Chandra, right? Which gives you really the resolution that you need to actually pin down if there are two point sources, you know, hard enough that is best explained by a pair of issues. So to summarize the statistics so far, it turned out the majority of these kinematic candidates turned out to be likely from these outflows or rotating disks of gas, which we'll talk about on the next slide. So it seems that the technique is not really super efficient, right? So you only get about 10% of success rate. And indeed, this has been confirmed by many different groups, and so people are thinking about other methods. However, there is a caveat here because there is also this big chunk of ambiguous case. Okay, so bear that in mind. So just hold on to that thought for a second. So what I really want to highlight is nice work done by ITC group here, which actually explained this low apparent frequency of this dual AGN or the kinematic splitting, at least at low redshift. Okay, so on the left, I'm showing you the simulations of a pair of disk-dominated galaxies that are going through this dual AGN phase. And the bottom line is because of the contamination of disk rotation, right, and also to some extent the low duty cycle of this AGN, we are seeing only a very tiny fraction of all the galaxies that actually go through this phase. So at least, so this is I think a nice, very nice example of connecting observations with theory. Okay. So now going back to that big chunk of question mark, these ambiguous case, and here I'm showing you one example of that. So actually turned out to be most likely a dual AGN. So this was missed because of the mismatch in terms of resolution and sensitivity. Right. So remember that we talked about the importance of resolution and also sensitivity. So these two factors that they are really difficult to come by at the same time. And with the combination of different medium and narrowband imaging with Hubble, we were able to conclude that this galaxy here, as an example, is likely to be dual AGN instead of those kinematics, rotating these or outflows. But what we really need is James Webb. So this is perfect for like a nurse back type of IFU to actually go and resolve the ionization gradient in the nuclear regions, because that's where you can actually resolve how the ionization potential changes as a function of distance to these potential nuclei. Okay, so the next two slides is what next, right? So what happened for these dual AGN if we do that time machine game? Well, it turned out that we can do this game out to reasonably high redshift, so at least as high as about 0.5. Because the relevant emission lines is still covered, right, in the optical. And this is what we did with the underweb, and it so getting interesting result, which may point to an even higher fraction of that biconical outflow, right, because we're seeing this evidence of the dependence of the fraction once you correct for the completeness, go to higher and higher value as you go to more and more luminous AGN. Why we want to do this? Well, some theory actually predicts as you go to higher and higher redshift, you expect to see a lower and lower frequency of this dual AGN system, right? So which is difficult to understand just intuitively, but I won't go into the details. Talk to me if you're interested. However, you can't do this game as you go to redshift about 1, because that's where your optical lines are redshifted out to the infrared. And at least for now, we don't yet have a large enough spectroscopic survey that is probing the raspberry optical, so the big near-infrared spectroscopic survey. So what we can do is using astrometry. So this is, so the most important thing on the slide is the picture of the grad student here, so I'm just gonna highlight his work, so my job is done there. But this is using the dark energy survey data, so specifically in the supernova field, where we have about weekly imaging of a large area on the sky, so you can play the trick of astrometry. And so before I explain how this works, so I also want to draw the analogy, so not just with the exoplanet, because with the exoplanet, so you actually have the exoplanet moving around, right? So what you see is the very center of the star that is being pulled by an unseen companion, right? So the very center actually moves as a function of time. But here, so the relevant physical scale is still at large distances, so the two bodies don't actually move, right, during the time of our observation. But what you see is the effective light that is coming from both components. Right? But because of their variability, right? So we know that AGN, they vary, so that's good. It turned out you can use their variability to gain resolution in time. Okay? And so that's the variability method. And another complementary method is using different colors. So you imagine you have two AGN that are very different colors, one red and one blue, or you have, you know, just one black hole active and other is the host, which tend to have different color. So you can use this different bands, right? Multiple bands to actually figure out if they're systematically offset from each other. You can't do this with single epoch just because of the PSF is so large. But astrometry accuracy is usually one or two orders of magnitude smaller than the PSF. So by using this astrometry trick, you actually gain about an order of magnitude in resolution. Okay, so this is, interestingly, I have a friend who work in biology, chemistry, so they, people use the super resolution imaging, right, as this microscopy, so-called. So this is our astro version of the super resolution imaging. There you have it. So I won't go into the detail, but this is just a very nice work done by my collaborator Yuan Lu, who made a proof of concept using that astrometry techniques, using both variability and color. And this was fortunately also pre-identified by some serendipitous survey that they were searching for these quasar lenses. A strong gravitational lensing, but it turned out that like 1 month's garbage is another month's treasure, and we Yuan actually used this to prove that it works with even with PTF data, right, which is not so good in terms of resolution and sensitivity. Okay, so I'm running a little bit behind, but I want to highlight another work which was actually done here. So this is going into the final parsec problem, right, where you have already, now we already have a binary, okay, that is gravitationally interacting with each other. So this is arguably the most exciting stage because it is crucial for understanding whether they can go into the gravitational wave emission regime, right, depending on if you run out of stars to interact with, or if you have gas, for that matter. So the bottom line is that again, we expect a lot of these systems because typical time scale is the longest, right? So you always play the game with probability. So you expect to see a lot of them, but there is just no direct evidence for systems in the subparsec, you know, tens of milliparsec regime. So just to orient you, the orbital periods that you expect is on the order of a decade to, you know, maybe 10th century for the longest. So depending on the mass of the system, so it sounds really long, right? So this is the main difficulty, actually. I didn't really think it through when I, you know, started this. So it's not recommended for a PhD thesis, by the way. But it turned out we can work out some clever way to actually probe the geometry without actually following the full binary cycle. Okay, I'm gonna go on to that next. So again, a slide just directly stolen from the website, thanks to exoplanet people. But I did order it so that instead of having, you know, a star and a planet around it, I have a pair of these binary black holes. One of them is active, okay, and the other is inactive. Okay, so this is our working model here. And just to remind you, now we're talking about these broad line regime, right? So because we're looking at these really subparsec closed binaries. So the technique works this way. For a typical quasar, we're talking about, so we have these broad H beta emission lines that is really on the order of a few thousand kilometers per second, because that from the gas that is sitting deep in the gravitational potential well, really close to the black holes, the broad light region gas. But occasionally, about a few percent of quasars actually show significant velocity offset in the broad lines with respect to the whole systemic velocity. Okay, so what's going on? So there is a mixed bag, the answer is. Okay, so you can have a binary system, as we talk about, but you can also have these so-called atypical disk emitters, which I show you in the middle, just illustrating how people actually explain. Remember that iron K alpha line? This is similar, but on the much outer region. So the iron K alpha is much further in, but the optical lines, they're further out. This is good because for the region that we are interested in, okay, so the subparsec regime, we need a tracer that is small enough so that we can still hope to have separate broad line regions, which is tracing the bulk velocity of a single black hole, instead of having a sort of common envelope scenario where you have a certain binary equation disk, okay? So, but there is also other various explanations for this, such as, you know, even more exotic like recoil, or more mundane galaxy cluster flyby, or chance superposition. So the most crucial thing that you can tell apart all these different scenarios is time domain spectroscopy. Okay, so you need spectroscopic monitoring that is long enough and also has a good cadence to tell which one of these is the origin for this. So I'm just showing you an example where for a separation about a year in a rest frame, you don't see any velocity shift in the line. Okay, so this rules out some of the parameter space in terms of the binary scenario. Okay, because you can imagine you can't have a binary in there but not producing, you know, observable velocity shift given the constraint on the binary orbital parameters. Okay. So on the bottom, just showing calibration. So we use narrow lines to calibrate systematic uncertainties. This is just the correlation, cross correlation result. However, in other cases, you do see good candidates for exactly the right amount of acceleration you would expect from the subparsec binary. And this is just one example where you see about 50 kilometers per second per year time of acceleration using this multi-epoch spectroscopy. What you really need is not just two epochs, and that's not the Cavalarian curve. So this is an exercise that really needs patience. But if you do that, and it turned out you have these good examples that could be explained by these subparsec binaries, and I'm just showing you that there is consistent and constant acceleration observed in both H-beta and H-alpha, but not in O3, okay? And it's consistent in the line profile so that you don't have to worry about variability, which I will go into later. So the next three slides are the question about what about this general quasar population, right? So we talked about quasars that show velocity offset, but what about just a general quasar, any given quasar, right? It could be that in their phase that is just projected this way that you don't see this velocity offset. Well, so we asked this question. So again, this was work done here. And the way, so what's shown here is the comparison between a population of these measured acceleration compared against this distribution that is purely induced by noise, okay? And on the top you see for very short scales, so as an example, I'm showing you 1 month time separation, the acceleration you see is consistent with being induced by noise, basically, okay? But if you go to longer time scales, say longer than here a month or even a year longer, you see substantial difference between the two, okay? So this is the evidence that you see this excess of acceleration on long time scales. So the next question we ask is, can this be explained by a population of binary system? Okay, so we go out and make really simple toy models. And this is just illustrating how you can play this trick. So what's shown here is the chaos probability of a model of binaries compared against the observed acceleration. Okay, so a model added on top of that noise that we saw with the short separation pairs. Now, well, our model is really simple, so it only has two free parameters, the binary fraction, which is the fraction of a subparsec binary out of all the quasars, and the second is the separation between the two in terms of the broad line region size. Okay, so a darker region means more likely. So the message that we get here is that if you have a really high binary fraction, or if you have a binary that is so close to each other, you're gonna run into a regime that the predicted acceleration is so large that is not gonna reproduce the observed value, so which is the upper lab of the region being ruled out. Okay, and the other end of the spectrum is if you have such a low binary fraction, or the separation is so large that their orbital velocity is still so low that, again, ruled out, this is the lower right column, okay? On top of that, you see this line, vertical line here, which is just the Roche radius, just so that our model is self-consistent, so that the broad line region is not disrupted. So that's how you rule out all the region to the left of this. So we're now left with this triangular island of permitted parameter space that's shown by this dark green region. Okay? All right, so this is the densest slide that I have, okay? But here I'm assuming a 1-to-1 mass ratio. And on this slide, I'm just relaxing that constraint and see how this changes if I allow the mass ratio of the binary to change. Okay, so the bottom line is the observed acceleration is actually consistent with a high binary fraction and more massive for the inactive companion and the separation that has to be not very large. Okay, it's our process scale. Okay, so I will quickly wrap up, but I'm just showing you this very important caveat, which we're, we'll be able to address, which is, this has something to do with the variability. So this is occurring on the dynamical timescale. So the broad line region is not actually stable on the timescale of our observation, because the orbital timescale is much longer than the dynamical timescale, right? So as you observe the binary to orbit, so there is dynamical changes in the broad line region, which will mimic, you know, a bulk velocity shift. So even though we can, you know, argue in terms of line shift, but it's not a clear cut evidence. Okay, so that's a big caveat. So how do you actually discriminate between these two? So there is a way, actually, right? So again, proposed by folks here, so which is using velocity resolved regression mapping, right? So regression mapping is a great technique that allows people to study the kinematics and geometry. And if you have really great data, such as Aegean storm, and if you have a really large sample, so you can do this sort of statistically, such as with SDSSRM or with a Sloan 5 project in future, so you can test this. So the idea how this works is basically you imagine two scenarios. So this is a binary, but this is a just one black hole sitting at the center. The broad emission line at different velocity will respond to the change in these two scenarios differently. So what I'm plotting you is the response function, right? So in terms of the disk scenario or single black hole scenario, you have the symmetric response, whereas in the binary scenario, you have the asymmetric response. So this is my last science slide, and I will summarize and then end, going back to the beginning of our talk. But I'm just highlighting others, so there are also other candidates that are being, you know, brought up, entertained, and this is a great subject to look into, especially given these various time domain photometric surveys that are both large enough and sensitive enough to find this really interesting target. And this is, again, just highlighting a grad student at U of I, Wei Ting, who is leading a work using the dark energy survey data. So combining the dark energy survey with the SDS is giving you a long enough time baseline of 20 years that is also sensitive enough to find these really faint and interesting targets. I won't go into the detail, but there's just other way. So to sum up, we have learned a great deal already, right? So filling up this parameter space. So for the dual AGN regime, we now have good evidence for their formation. So this is the stage where it was uncertain because we don't know if they can mate to the gravitationally bound binary, right? So we have effective methods with caveats, and the model prediction can explain the observation reasonably well. On the other hand, for the sub-parsec regime, we have these interesting candidates. So I just told you about just one particular category, but there is also other methods, such as with the variability selection, but with big caveats, right? So we really need these long-term monitoring, like this regression mapping programs, to figure out what's going on with the actual geometry and kinematics in the brown lines. But the future is really bright. Again, without going into the details, so there's the main takeaway from this is in these keywords. Okay, so this goes back to our early discussion of why this problem has been so difficult. So I think, which is why for our observers have really been dragging us behind. So now is the time for us to really catch up to theorists. Okay, so finally, I just want to go back to the beginning of our talk. So this is our nice guy that is close and dear to our hearts. Remember that Andromeda head-on collision, this is what it will look like, okay? So I'll just go through this, and there, is it showing up? Right, there we go. So this is probably NGC 60-40 scenario happening, but within our own galaxy, how about that? Wait, this is getting even better than this, okay? So the aftermath of this, looks really dim because like some may even argue that there's really no hope of doing extragalactic astronomy because we just won't see those light that is from these external galaxies. But depending on how this goes, there's a silver lining to it. We're left with this pair of black holes in our own galaxy. Okay, thank you very much.
So questions?
But of course, there is another interesting aspect of this, which is the recoil that potentially can result from. There are some candidate systems we talk about where you have the remnant black hole recoiling just due to the fact that the gravitational wave emission is not isotropic during the merger.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, I definitely think that's a very exciting possibility. So just for the rest of us who are not very familiar with recoil, now I'm just pretending I'm a theorist, but so from the anisotropic radiation of the gravitational wave, so expect this recoil, right? So like a back reaction, right? So the net result is that this merger product, so now we had these two black holes, but now have just one black hole, but it could be pushed away from the center, so depending on how large a push, you can potentially see this effect. Now, I don't think that people have looked hard enough for this, so I definitely see a lot of potential. But the main difficulty is that we're not particularly winning in terms of probability. I don't want to say that 100% because it really depends on how large the velocity, right? So there's evidence, and unless you have this really particular configuration, you are not gonna get a really large, like 1,000 kilometers per second kick. So if it's just a small kick, and if it's not really far away from the center, and if it's too far away from the center, it's rammed into the halo, and it just wanders there without responding accretion of gas, it's very faint. But again, I think there's a lot of hand waving going on here, but I'm just really glad that the community is looking into this, like really seriously. Even if we don't detect anything, I think it would be interesting to get upper limit.
Other questions? Yeah, let's thank our speaker again.